Hey everybody, welcome to the shop at Jet City Turbines. It is a Sunday, and in the midst of the near panic worldwide, never thought I'd be saying this, due to a global pandemic, I thought I would focus not on the negative, but on the positive. And it sort of came to me a few weeks ago that I think I'm very lucky for many reasons, but one particular reason is I'm a member of what I would imagine to be a very small group of people. And those are the people that have been in the pilot seat of an F-86 and started the engine in the plane, and have also had, as well as building the engine, had the engine in the test cell and started it and run it. So there's a lot of pilots who've flown F-86s. There's a lot of people who work in engine test cells, and there's quite a few people who've worked on Orendas. And I'm in the lucky spot where all three of those have converged into one group of people. I don't know how big that group of people is, but I'm in it. So what we're going to do today is we're going to go over the starting sequence, how it differs when you're sitting in the plane in the pilot seat of this single engine fighter jet from the 1950s. Super duper cool. And also when you're in our test cell. So our test cell is not custom made just for this engine. So all the interface with the engine and the sensors and the controls doesn't go through these two cable connections, which are actually these two cables go the other side, and you just put two cables in and it connects up to the wiring harness. No, we have to do everything the hard way, the manual way. We have to hook up all the separate things discreetly, I suppose, right to the point to point, as you'd say. So we're going to go through the books a little bit on the Sabre. It's actually this book. It is the Pilot's Operating Instructions for the Sabre 6. The Canadair Sabre 6 is the Canadian license-built version of the North American Sabre. It's for all intents and purposes, it's the same plane with minor differences because the engine is the Orenda 14 as opposed to the J47. They're very similar engines. One's built in the States and one's built in Canada. Yeah. So we're going to use that book, and we're also going to use our standard procedures in our test cell based on the overhaul manual's testing requirements for the Orenda 14. Okay, so let's see. This is the book. There's one interesting diagram that you might want to see before we get started. It talks about everything you need to do to be a pilot in this plane. Where's that diagram? I think it's probably over here. Maybe not. Yes, here it is. This is, can you see that? Let's just make sure you can see it. Oh yeah. This is the minimum safe distances for the F-86F with an Orenda 14 in it, which is what we just ran in the test cell. You've got at 25 feet, the exhaust that's behind, the exhaust is 480 miles an hour at 375 degrees. So if you want your high speed roast beef being ripped off your face, that's where you stand. This of course is at maximum power. At 50 feet, it's 200 miles an hour at 195 or 90 Celsius. At 75 feet, it's 115 miles an hour at 55. However, you see how this hits the ground? The rocks and bits of debris that this jet picks up at 75 feet will almost be going the same speed as the 25. So the air is going 115, but the rocks and sticks are going 400, something like that, and they're gonna hurt. So don't do this. And in the front, it shows a 25-foot circle. There's less noise up here, and probably less danger of being pulled in, or pushed in really, by the air pressure around it than from the test cell. The test cell is more, we give it more than 25 feet. Now some people, just a second. Some people have complained and commented quite recently how stupid we are for walking in front of the engine because it's unsafe and it's dangerous. And I love to be corrected by ignorant people. It's a lot of fun. Basically, the greater the engine power and RPM, the greater the danger of being pulled in. When the engine is at idling, there's nothing. It's good practice not to be there, but if you have to pass in front of the engine and you're 5 feet in front of it when it's idling, you're fine. You just want to make sure you don't have handkerchiefs or hats or anything in your pocket, and you can do that. Nothing wrong with staying 25 feet away at all times, or 50. Just saying that the danger of debris being pulled into the engine is very dependent, actually exponentially dependent, on the power rating. So those people that have told us that we're idiots, we may be idiots for other reasons, but we're not idiots because we're going to get sucked into a jet engine. Yeah, I just wanted to cover that again for the 100th time. Thank you. Okay, just a little bit of background information before we start this. This is the left-hand side of the cockpit, the throttle control lever. Second little detail. This is the right-hand side. There is a, let's see, the battery starter switch, 7, battery starter and push to stop starter. The battery starter switch, number 7, is a combination starter generator unit is provided for cranking the engine. An external power source must be used for starting, as the battery, as the starter cannot be powered by the aircraft battery. The battery starter switch on the engine control panel operates the starter when held momentarily in the starter position. A starter relay continues to energize the starter until engine speed reaches the required RPM, at which point the starter circuit is automatically disconnected. Okay. You know, I almost forgot about this place. This is one of the several classified storage and modification areas in the S&S Empire. And those, believe it or not, that is a wall of Saab Draken engines. Yeah. But anyway, we're not there for that. We're here for this. Right next to the Orenda Iroquois, all bundled up, we have an F-86 Sabre. Actually, it's a Canadair Sabre 6. Doesn't everybody? And we're gonna go in there. We're gonna hop in the cockpit. It's pretty decrepit, but it's got all the things basically there. And we're gonna see how you start this plane. I think I'm gonna enter from the, you can get in from either side. Look at that. I thought it was left side only. There's a step there. Yeah, let's try that. Hang on. Okay, so it's in pretty sad shape. Pretty decrepit. But I'm going to climb in here and we're going to look at the things you need to do to start your Sabre. Just hang on while I enter the decrepit zone. Yes, decrepit zone. Okay, it's pretty cramped in here, but let's take a look. We've got our throttle quadrant, which I'm hoping you can see. It's got a stop there, and it is adjustable. Okay, so what you do to get in your plane, or to start your plane, you have to turn on the main circuit breaker. Oh, look at this over here. Engine master switch on. Okay, then you've got to come over here and you've got to move your throttle quadrant out and past the idle stop. You let it sit there. Now, I just left this in this position when I then started it by going with this switch, the battery, and battery starter switch. So I did this. I did that, and then I sat back. I watched the RPM slowly. This is a two-lap RPM tachometer. Where is the EGT? Exhaust temperature. It's pretty corroded, so you can't really see in that. This is an old and very retired aircraft. It's going to need a lot of work if it's ever going to fly again. Anyway, you got your EGT, you got your percent RPM. You've got, where's the oil pressure? Oil pressure should be right down here, right down there. And it's reading a little bit now because the sensor is probably out of whack. So then you sit here and you let everything do what it's got to do. And eventually this settles in at around 40%, 38 to 41%. So that's going to be, it's going to come around to about there, the big hand. And it goes around all the way to get to 100, goes around twice. And you could see that. Okay, so, and your EGT is going to settle into, I can't remember what it was exactly, but probably around 700 Fahrenheit. Around 700. And here we go. And then you want to give it the beans. You slide it forward and things accelerate. So from my point of view, compared to the test cell, this is way easier. And it's way cooler because you're sitting in a jet fighter. Push throttle lever outboard for ignition and boost pump. So I guess you could leave it there. I don't think you're supposed to leave it there. And that's where it sits for idle. Microphone, speed brakes. Machine gun, rockets, bombs. I don't know what those are. The book will tell us if we want to learn which switch drops the bombs and which one fires the machine guns. Very cool. Inside a decrepit Canadair Sabre 6. Let's get out of here. Oh wait, airspeed. Airspeed's got the max set at 560. I guess they don't want you to go faster than 560. Mach number. It goes up to 1.5 rather optimistically. Interesting. Super duper cool. And your parking brake, just like in your what's it called? A Ford Country Squire. That's right, the Ford Country Squire. Yes, the wagon that we had when I was a kid. Oh, I found the holy crap switch. This would be jettison bomb rocket tank. And this is jettison all external stores. So tanks, rockets, bombs, everything. You have to bring this guard up and hit that. That's drop everything. And then that's the way it stays in flight. So you can't accidentally hit it. That would be quite disastrous. Service this aircraft with something, something. NATO F-34 AVTUR. That's jet fuel. Jet fuel. That's what you want in your jet fighter. Very cool. The RPM comes up. The engine starts burning fuel. The EGT goes way up. The RPM comes up some more. The EGT comes down. And then it just settles into idle. And it's all happy. It was great. Okay. So, let's go to the test cell and we'll compare that to how we do it manually. Right here is the, what they call it, power lever or throttle actuator link. And if you can see there, it's pretty old, but it should say off there. Should say idle. And then these are not percentages. It goes 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, and then mil. So those are degrees of throttle movement. I don't know why they did that, but they did that. So it says mil and TO, takeoff. Now, that's interesting because in the manual, this is the thing, but in the book about the thing, it describes takeoff power as being above mil power. So let's just try not to worry too much about that. And this one says, what does that say? It probably says NOM for nominal. That's nominal maximum. So that's what you're going to be doing your patrols and your traverses and your your combat actions at. Mil would be absolute bleeding maximum when you need it. And takeoff is your takeoff power. So both very high levels of power. Your nominal would be your nominal, your basic. This is about 6,000 pounds of thrust, 6,500 maybe. This is 7,600, 7,200 to 7,500, something like that. So a bit more thrust. Anyway, this is the thing that feeds the engine the gas. You can see there's a minimum stop there. Sorry, I'm looking at it with my eyes, not the camera. There's a min stop right there. You can't go lower than off. And there should be a max. Yeah, there's a, you can see how that same thing hits for a max. So the min max of the fuel control is greater than the min max needed by the engine. Anyway, this is the power lever and that's the pointer indicator. So there, right there is idle, which is also starting. Right there, there's a little box there, a little range. So that'll become important in a few minutes. Hey, I've had to reshoot this video because one of the hard disks in my computer's dying, but in that time, we've got an Orenda 10 in the test cell to be tested. And you can see all the things that had to be hooked up by hand to our sensors. Normally this would all just plug into, let's see, let's go around. It's not fully installed, but it's getting there. It would plug into here. These two connections take all the output from the instruments and sensors to the aircraft. And then it's very simple and easy. So the engine change in a Sabre takes, oh, I think less than an hour. For us, it takes a few hours to hook it up in our test cell with our guard dog keeping an eye on us. Okay, this is our computer control screen. And it says J79 up there, not Orenda, because we use this one to measure thrust. Right there is one of our piezoelectric load cells. There's one on either side and they give us electrical signal based on how much force is on them. We add the signal of both of them together and that's the total amount of force being placed on this moving cradle. Right now the thrust is reading 29 pounds, which is just a residual in the piezoelectric force transducers. But the main thing is the T-bar is the throttle. So it's an electronically controlled actuator on the engine. And the boys have hooked up the electronic actuator. It's right here, right where it's supposed to be. And it's on this interesting brace because this thing here is connected to a cable that goes up to a pulley, which is right about there in the aircraft. So since we don't have an aircraft fuselage, we simulate the fuselage with this thing. So this is our little F-86 Sabre simulator. Canadair Sabre 6 simulator. Very cool.
Goes from 0 to 3,000. So what I need to do is on the fuel control, there's an idle block where it's about 12%, something like that. And so we've got to have a guy out there. We move this until that indicator says 12%, and it was 575 at the last test anyway. So we write that number down. And what I need to do is I need to give the signal to the start card guy to energize. Usually it's thumbs up. Then I start a timer on my phone, 45 seconds. The starter can go for a maximum of 45 seconds. When the RPM gets to 500, I switch on the ignition. When it gets to 700, I bring the throttle up to start, which is 575, we established last time. So I'm being pretty slow here. I need to practice a few times. You want to bring it up very quickly because if the RPM gets too high, the engine won't start because there's too much air rushing and it blows the fuel away from the spark igniters. Then you'll hear, within a second or two, you'll hear the engine catch, kind of a boom or a rumble, and you look at EGT, the maximum is 1560. It'll typically go to 1350, something like that, which is well under, which keeps everybody happy. The RPM keeps climbing. Now that it's fuel burning, you can shut the ignition off. You keep the throttle where it was, 570 here. The RPM will keep rising. When it gets to 1800, you signal the start cart guy to shut it off. I usually do this because you've assisted the engine up through its struggles from initial fuel burning to self-sustaining RPM and then to idle. And idle for this is around 3,000, 2850 to 3,000. When it gets to 1800, you tell the starter to cut out, and then you leave it here until this slowly comes up to 2850-ish, and you'll see the ignition, or the EGT will go way up to about 1350. It'll slowly start to come down as the cooling air goes up and up and up with RPM, and it meets at 3000, and this will be about 760, and the oil pressure will be around 8, something like that, and everybody's happy. So on this screen we also have a vibration probe on the front of the engine, a vibration at the rear. There's 4 channels, we only use 2 of them for this engine. Fuel inlet temperature is not measured. Oil sump temperature, that's our reservoir. We usually warm up the oil to about 100 degrees Fahrenheit. Right now it's 63.5 because it's a heated building. We get it to about 100 before we start increasing power. Ambient temperature, we measure. CDP is compressor discharge pressure. You'll see this go up to about 4 or 5 pounds per square inch for starting, but when the engine's running at maximum power, it's gonna be around 70. So these other categories we aren't using. There's no variable VSVs, so we're not using those. But the T-bar is an important thing, and typically it'll keep increasing up until 7,800 RPM, which is red line, and the T-bar is about something like that, 1,700, 1,800. And from 1,800 all the way to 3,000, nothing much happens because the automatic governors in the fuel pumps are set to hold the engine at its maximum RPM when the throttle is at maximum. So there's a lot of things to go through, and a lot of times I'll be here running this and somebody will be pointing to the ignition switch. Like, you shouldn't leave it on all the time because the spark plugs, the sparking plugs, the igniter plugs, they'll wear out because there's such a huge spark going through them. So they point to that and I turn it off. Once the engine's running, you can turn it off, no problem. So it's quite a bit different experience than starting in the plane. Let me tell you, there's a lot to pay attention to. It's all done manually, and it makes you real nervous the first few times you do it. I always get nervous doing it because you're always thinking about all the different things that could go wrong. So that's all you're doing. It's not automatic. Anyway, in the test cell on a very snowy Sunday in front of our control screen, a couple of days away from running that engine. Thanks for watching.